He's a weird dude, yeah. I'm not crazy about him. I'll just leave that one alone. I don't want to get too far. No, I'm not. No, I'm not. No, I'm not. Yeah. get me out of here, Ben.
So, needless to say, David, we wanted to get in touch with you based on some of the discussion on social media the last little while. Are you done owning Nike equipment? We'll start there.
You know, it's one of those things that, you know, I've never been into material things. You know, I've never been a big Nike guy or big Under Armour guy. You know, I just, whatever the team gives me, you know, the team always provides you with stuff, and that's the stuff that I wear. But, yeah, I mean, you know, there's certain things that you take a stand for. And, you know, if there's three different companies there, New Balance, Under Armour, and Nike, I'm probably not going to go with Nike. Just that's probably my first thought right now off the top of my head.
David, I'll give you the chance to explain the original tweet that seemed to equate the slogan with 9/11. Give us the lowdown on if you want to take that back or if you'd like to clarify.
Yeah, you know, it's so hard to kind of express yourself or express the meaning behind what you're saying in 160 characters on Twitter. You know, there's no, it's not a terrorist or racial issue. It's a logical issue, as in sacrificing everything. And that's something that I just don't understand the concept there. And so that's why I was equating just that logic, that sacrificing everything. If someone just puts those words up on their wall, you know, and just looks at them, you know, that's in my opinion, how to take these things to extreme. So, you know, it was just a way of me not understanding Nike's, angle here. So, I just didn't think that it flowed from what they were trying to do. I think Nike has a right, Colin Kaepernick has a right to do what they do, and that's not something that I disagree with. It's just more of the wording, I guess, that was just kind of intrigued me.
Sure, but I mean, it's a marketing slogan, David. You took it literally?
No, like I said, I didn't take it literally. I just think that we're not holding words accountable. I think that words do have meaning and that we need certain meanings. Yes, I mean, you know, you're able to, in the free world, you have your First Amendment rights. You're able to do those things. That's where, you know, just like I was doing, I have a right to express myself, and I just maybe just didn't agree with it. And so that's kind of where I was like, oh, I don't know. It's just something that was on my mind. I haven't been on Twitter for a while. I didn't know it was going to cause, I figured it's caused a little bit of ruckus, but you know, it's good to have debates. And I've always been a guy that enjoys debates. I watch debates online. Got my pilot's license. I enjoy studying and learning, and I think this is a very big topic right now. And so I just like hearing different viewpoints on the issues at hand. And so that's kind of, you know, engaging. You know, I got a lot of more just, I want to say, and you know, I'm a bad hockey player and I sucked as a Canuck. I didn't really, those arguments to me didn't really work out too well. But like I said, I'm always open, and that's kind of why I'm on, I guess, taking this time is to just discuss bigger issues in a very respectful manner. And you know, whether I'm right or wrong, I think there's people on both sides of the debate. So you know, I'm probably in the minority on this radio station, which is fine, but you know, that's understandable.
Well, debate, it's what we do every day, and we do respect you making the time to have it with us. We're with David Booth, formerly the Vancouver Canucks.
I think a lot of people are probably struggling, David. Did you give 110% as a player every night?
I mean, could you ask that of every single person, every single NHL player that...
okay, you know, let me rephrase. Did you, on certain nights, did you give 110%?
You know what? I think I try to do it every day. I think you can ask people that I played with that. That was something that, yeah, there's days you feel tired. There's days that you don't want to. But I think when you have a greater cause at hand, sometimes you have to dig deep and you know, just battle through. You're not going to feel 100%. I think that's what's so special about hockey players is they find a way to play through when they're not feeling 100% and to grind it out. I think they're tremendous warriors and tremendous competitors is a better word. Tremendous competitors, and they do that night in and night out, which makes hockey such a great sport.
My point is, David, I guess we hear that cliche a ton in sports, in hockey in particular, and you know, there's only 100% to give. You know, there are catchphrases that are used in the English language that just, you know, mean something within the context. And I guess I'm struggling with, you know, why you thought that there was a misuse of the English language here. I think most people that read Sacrifice and Everything read it within the context of his career and his ability to play in the National Football League, as opposed to anything beyond that. So I'm just wondering where you struggled with that context when it comes to anything. Yeah, you know, as Matt pointed out earlier, marketing slogans are meant within context, not as proverbs in any sacred scripture.
Yeah, you know what, and I think the slogan would have been just fine, you know, if they ended it at sacrifice. You know, I don't really believe he sacrificed everything, and that's what they're claiming he did. He sacrificed everything. I think the term sacrifice everything is reserved for military people, law enforcement. You know, you guys know my beliefs, even Jesus. Those are people that you look to that when you hear that sacrifice everything, that is reserved, I want to say, for those people. And so if they would have said sacrifice, I think that's sure. Where you can draw the line and say, yeah, you know what, believe in something even if you have to sacrifice. And, you know, I don't think he sacrificed his career. I mean, there's still many players that kneel during the national anthem since he did that, and they haven't lost their career. So he didn't. I don't see the correlation there. It just doesn't add up. What they're doing is they're playing on emotions versus on reality, and that's what I don't like, is when they kind of play on emotions. And you know what? Nike's smart. I think they're playing on emotions instead of playing on the reality of the situation.
Sure. David, first, Dr. King on that list as well? People who sacrificed everything?
Absolutely. Yeah. Okay. Actually, yeah, that's a great point. Martin Luther King, you know, and Pat Tillman, you know, that's just people that come to mind as well.
Sure. And maybe in an athletic context, Ali, for what he sacrificed career-wise as a conscientious objector. Okay, so, I mean, if we're in a linguist class and breaking down language, sure, I understand what you're saying. I think what people were troubled with is that you went to the example of planes flying into buildings. Where did that come from, and why that particular example?
You know, I don't know. You know, being a U.S. Citizen, you know, that was very, I remember exactly where it was on that day. I think it's for a lot of people. It's
being a Canadian, I remember. there are not many people who don't remember where they were that day.
You know, and so it's just using one extreme. Like, they used an extreme of sacrificing everything. So, you know, I guess me going on extreme in that end, in the sense that, did he really sacrifice everything? I don't believe so. So if I take that to the other side of the extreme and use that example, I mean, I just have so much pride for our country. I mean, if I was just someone that just lived in the United States, never been anywhere, you know, maybe, you know, I'm not the best person to talk to, but, and I'm not saying I am, but living in Russia for 2 years, traveling to Ukraine, being in Egypt, the United States, and seeing the way most of the world is oppressed, it's shocking. And you know, as Christians, we're called to care for the oppressed. I mean, I remember in Vancouver, my time, I took time to create a nice wild game dinner for the oppressed in Vancouver. I didn't need to make a statement by, you know, doing anything political. I just did it quietly on my own time. And I think it raised awareness within those communities. And I think there's other ways to raise awareness. I mean, that's great that he did. And Colin shed light on this. I'm not bashing him for this, because he shed light on it. I just think there's other ways that perhaps could have been done. And you know, we all have our opinions on that.
Unfortunately, David, that's not the only tweet I have to ask you about. One of your follow-ups in this conversation was said it's like you typed out, it's like telling your son they can become a girl even if they are a boy. It's that messed up. Needless to say, that's going to strike some as very insensitive to the trans community.
Yeah, and you know what? That's, again, that's just a logical thing. I mean, I'm not here to get into every single one of my tweets. You know, I don't want to be pulled in that direction. But I just think that, you know, we have certain ideas or certain realities that we need to address. And you know what? I actually, believe it or not, I wrote this was when we had Hockey Is For Everyone night, and a lot was on my mind then. I actually wrote 2 pages just on my thoughts on it, and it was out of love. And I think, you know, I've been surrounded by people in that community. My wife is a model. She works with a lot of gays and lesbians, and we have some very close gay and lesbian friends. So it's not that we dislike them or, you know, that we're bashing them. We actually love them. And, you know, that's why, like I told you, I wrote a whole 2-page thing on it. I haven't really posted it yet because sometimes, you know, people just immediately throw up guards without really reading it. And it was more out of a love thing and something that, you know, I definitely, I have my opinions on it. And I think it's just a good discussion to have. So, you know, I know that would probably cause another conversation and hopefully a respected conversation, not just name calling and bashing. And that was my intent there.
Yeah. And none of that here. When you say it's a logical thing, David, I mean, I understand there are males and females, two genders. It's also medically proven that there are certain people who are born with characteristics of both. And there are certain people who feel that they have been assigned the wrong gender.
Yeah, I mean, those are the exceptions. They're not the rule. So I don't think you can base something based on the exception and not the rule. I mean, if I were to say, you know, if a kid were to say, hey, you know, I want to be a Chinese person. I want to be an Indian. I want to be, you know, a Canadian or whatever you were. That's just impossible. You can't do that. That's just the science behind how you were born. And, you know, I want to be 6'7". Well, you can't do that. There's just certain things that, you know, you can't do it. Like I said, I'm not here to get into a whole sidetrack. I saw was, you know, and so I have my viewpoints, and trust me, I'm not the best one to be talking about these. These are very tough issues to address, and I think they take a lot of thought behind it and a lot of learning. And that's what I'm trying to do. I'm just trying to hear people out.
Sure. And civil,
and just get better information.
Civil policy, absolutely. Lots of debate, lots of texture. I guess I would suggest that a person's, you know, own hearts and feelings, that sort of isn't up for debate, David. That's if that's what they feel, don't they deserve the respect to feel like they feel?
Well, and that's where you go. That's kind of basically what I was arguing in the first place. I mean, just because they feel a certain way, like where do you draw the line? There has to be a line somewhere where you draw and to say that is wrong. Like that's where I go back to the extreme and saying it is wrong to fly a plane into a building. Like just because you feel that way, like if I have feelings towards a 7-year-old kid, is that right? I think we have a morality within us all.
Yeah.
And we need to live within that morality. There has to be laws written on our hearts, and I think we have to draw the line.
Well, David, the line is,
say, you know,
the line is clearly somewhere between pedophilia and mass murder, and I just feel like I'd like to live like a woman or a man, right? I guess that's where we're having a little bit of trouble.
One affects another person. One
affects
doesn't.
Another, yeah, greatly. The other doesn't necessarily.
I think it does affect other people. It affects our society. It affects the way our laws are written. It affects our whole community because now there are certain laws that are being in place that affect, you know, people in the church are now being called homophobes or whatever, you know, just because they share a different viewpoint than someone else. So it actually does affect us beyond just what you do in private. And so that's where I see that. And it just doesn't makes sense. So
I understand that, David. I understand that. Let me just get back to this. I mean, you said as Christians, you're supposed to care for the oppressed. I would suggest the gay and lesbian transgendered community has been oppressed in the past, and thus they're to be cared for. Correct?
Hey, you know what? Like I said, we love them, we care for them, and that's something that I think love goes beyond always just accepting. Like, love is much deeper than just saying do whatever you want. I think love, like, if you're raising your kid and you love them so they can eat all the Snicker bars in the world and all the ice cream, then they're going to be destructed. You're going to destruct that child. So love is something deeper than just saying do whatever you want, and I think that needs to be taken into consideration.
Well, the debate goes on. Plenty to agree on, plenty more to disagree on. But David, commend you for the charity work you did here in Vancouver and for taking the time out of your day today. Appreciate it.